Hello there. I'm Sonia Mehta and I'm a children's writer. I live in Bombay and I have been writing for I think pretty much all my adult life. In the beginning I wrote for magazines and newspapers, and then I created one of India's first newspapers for children, and that brought me firmly into the children's space, and there's been no looking back ever since then. So over the years I've written a lot of books. I started a company called, I co-founded this company called Quadrum Solutions, in which we created, I think, literally thousands of books for kids in the education space as well as the supplementary space. Then I've created a co-founded a company called Pod Squad, which creates learning tools for children. All sorts of little tools which help them learn using manipulatives and stories and books and flashcards. And then, of course, I have been writing books for kids. I always have believed that the best way for children to learn is through stories. And because I love writing and because I have kids and now I have grandkids, that's kept me in the children's space quite firmly for the longest time. Now, I always have felt that while it is wonderful for children to read stories, it's also a great time to give them that little something extra in the story, which makes them think, which adds a little value to the way they think. So most of my books have that little something. And just to tell you what I mean by that, for example, this is a series called Dealing with Feelings, and this deals with the feelings that children go through, you know, anxiety, jealousy, being left out. But all of that is done through these fun little stories and activities. They're fun little animals. So this is one way. Another series that I've done is which helps build values about sharing and loyalty and respect. Again, these are fun stories with activities. That brings me to one of my all-time favorites, which is the Discover India series. So this one is about, there's a book on every single state of India. And this was inspired by the fact that I grew up literally all over India because my father was in the army. And I realized that there just is so much for children to learn. Forget children, for us to learn. So this series does exactly that. It talks about India's history and culture. And then there's another series, which is an environmental series, which is their environmental mysteries. So children learn about the importance of water, about recycling, about pollution, through these little fun characters called the Econuts, who solve mysteries. They solve environmental mysteries. And then there are tips and tricks on how what children can do. So that, in a big nutshell, is me. I write for kids, or many of these books I've done are for Puffin India, and I have got loads of ideas coming up, and I just want to write all the time. When did I decide to become a writer? I think in the fifth standard, when I wrote my first poem. It was called Beautiful Nature, of course, hugely inspired by Enid Blyton. But okay, honestly, I think I have always been writing, as I said. It just drew me, I guess that was something that I enjoyed. But it was when I had children, and I found that keeping them engaged and keeping them occupied in needed me to be as creative as I could be, coming up with new stories all the time, and thinking of different characters and different ways to keep them engaged, occupied, and keep their imagination going. So I think that when my children were young, was the first time when I got into children's writing in a very big way. And as I said before, that was it for me. I mean, you know, I just found my space in it. I just simply found that it was the most rewarding and the most happy thing, because you know, I could see the response. I could actually see the impact that my books were having, as well as my articles for children in those days were having. So that was pretty much when I started writing as a full-time occupation. What inspires me to write? Okay, that's a good question, because honestly, I feel inspiration is just everywhere. Like I said before, it's you know, the need when you have children, and now I have grandchildren who kind of you know, keep me on my toes and keep my mind constantly working. But essentially, the environment throws ideas at you. For example, when this whole COVID thing started, I wrote a poem about Gyrus the coronavirus, which I wrote, I think, in the first week of COVID starting. And I just wrote that poem. I didn't do anything with it, but I put it out on YouTube and it's there for anyone to hear and see. But that was one of the first narratives, a fun narrative about a little coronavirus that everybody's trying to get rid of, because I wanted to explain to children without alarming them why it was important to stay home and wash their hands, and you know, how I manifested the virus as a character who they were going to get rid of. So that environment inspired me to write this. When I come across children, when I see my own daughter dealing with her children, you know, it's I see the kind of issues that young mothers are battling with, which are very different issues from the time when I was a young mother. That inspires me, because I say, okay, they are dealing with other issues that we didn't have to deal with. And a book, a storybook, is a great way to enter their minds. So that inspiration just comes at me from everywhere. Who was my favorite storyteller? Okay, as a child, I'd say I had two storytellers. One was through the books that I read, and the other was the stories that I heard. So my favorite storyteller as a writer is, a lot of people from my generation are going to say this, was without doubt Enid Blyton. You know, me and my brother and my cousins, we all lived together in Goa at that time. And you know, there used to be a contest as to who would read faster, who would read which book faster. And you know, soon all these characters, Fatty and Pip, and you know, when you say Enid Blyton, it goes right from Noddy upwards up to The Adventurous Four and all the books. So I'd say that Enid Blyton was my first inspiration, or my first author that I completely fell in love with. The other storyteller, honestly, I have to say, when I think about it, was my father. So my father was an actor. Although he was in the army, he also acted on the Marathi stage, and so he really had this way of narrating. So I remember when we were kids, whenever he was home on leave, he would collect all of us, as many children as possible, and put off the lights and tell us ghost stories and things like that. So I think he was possibly my favorite storyteller as a child. To be a character in a book, okay, there are two. One is the children's segment, a children's book, and the other is adult. If I was a character, I think I would like to be Hermione Granger. I like her spunk. I like her standing up for what she believes in. I like the fact that she's got a social conscience. And of course, this obviously means that I've just read Harry Potter again very recently, so it's very up there in my mind. But I think all the characters have been created beautifully, but Hermione Granger is somebody who I really like. And in an adult book, I think Pride and Prejudice, I would love to be Elizabeth Bennet, probably because she got Mr. Darcy at the end. That's very non-feminist, but I like her as well. I like her, again, her spunk, and I love the era in which she lived. So I would say Elizabeth Bennet in Pride and Prejudice and Hermione Granger in Harry Potter. If I were a book, what would my title be? That's a wonderful question. And I've thought a lot about it. I talked about it with my husband, and we both discussed what I would be if I were a book. I think my name would be Giggles, Chuckles and Snorts, because I believe that there's nothing as good as laughter. you know, we all spend so much time working out. I'm, you know, during lockdown, we're walking up and down in the house, or in, if we have lucky enough to have a garden, we're walking there. But I feel a good laugh is a workout for your soul. Have you never felt it, that once you've had a really good laugh, you found something really funny, or you've just had a pointless, meaningless bout of laughter, at the end of it, don't you feel good? I do. So I feel like laughter is like a workout for the soul, you know. And so my book, if I were a book, I would be called Giggles. What did I say? Giggles, Chuckles and Snorts. If it was a slightly more serious book, it would probably be called She Who Laughs Lasts. But yeah, it would be about laughter. What is my favorite childhood book? Now that's a little hard to say, because my childhood obviously goes through so many phases, and it would be hard for me to pick one. But you know, all of Enid Blyton books were my favorites. I loved them all. I loved Nancy Drew. But I think if there's one book that's really stayed with me in terms of its concept, it's The Kabuliwala. And I don't know when I read it, in what form I read it, but it's been there. And you know, there's so much in it which has made me you know, laugh and cry and identify with so many emotions that I still identify with it. So I would say The Kabuliwala if there was a single book. Funny anecdote from my childhood. Okay, so like I said, I was so inspired by Enid Blyton, my brother and I, and we used to live in places like Shillong and Babina and all. So we created these secret societies, of course inspired by Secret Seven, and we were lucky enough to actually have a shed in our garden, just like the Five Fine Daughters did. And we decided to have a secret society and a password. And nobody, all our friends, we had a group of 6 or 7 friends, would not be allowed in without the password. And one day I forgot the password. So by rights, I should have been able to cajole my brother, convince him, and you know, but nobody would let me in. And I remember I was the youngest, nobody would let me in, until it became a huge issue in the house and I had to tell my parents, and everybody got into it and said, come on, give her the password. So I think I remember that as being one of the fun times in my life, where a book actually sort of influenced us enough to for us to live like that, in a fun way, of course. Apart from writing, what do I do? What do I love to do? Well, reading, that goes without saying. Obviously, if I write, I would love to read, and our home is just chock-a-block with books. And I also read on the Kindle, so reading is, you know, I cannot fall asleep if I don't read for at least 2 minutes. Ideally an hour or two, but at least 2 minutes. But I have to read a good couple of hours every single day. The other thing that the lockdown has brought about is I've discovered a joy of doodling. So I love doodling. So I've been doodling my heart out, because suddenly with the lockdown, we don't have to go to work. There's no logistics involved and I have a load of time. And so there would be reading, there'd be doodling, and spending time with my 2 grandchildren who are 3 and 1. So they are the perfect age for me to test out all my ideas and stories. If books were my friend, what would a library be? I think a library would be my notion of heaven. I can imagine heaven as being a place where you just go and then there are just bookshelves after bookshelves after bookshelves. You know, I have been, as a part of Quadrum, as I mentioned earlier, we have been visiting the book fairs, the large book fairs internationally. So we go to the Frankfurt Book Fair and the London Book Fair and the Bologna Book Fair. And honestly, I actually feel as if I'm in heaven, because you know, there're just books everywhere. Also, I must tell you that when we were kids, we couldn't just buy books, you know. We were always at some far-flung army post, so there was no access to as many bookstores. So we would rely heavily on libraries. And some of the libraries, like the one in Goa, in Panjim, we used to actually, as soon as there were holidays, we were not allowed to take books home from that library, or I think we were allowed to take one book home, but we were actually reading more than one at one time. So what we would do is take one book to read at home, and actually spend the whole day in the library. So we would go there in the morning, pick a book, read it, go home for lunch, come back in the afternoon, read till it was closing time, and then take one book and read it at home. So I would think that a library would be heaven. For me, it certainly has been heaven. What message would I give young readers? Keep on reading. Just keep on reading. But you know, at this point of time, as much as it's a message for young readers, I think it's also a message that I'd like to give young parents, which is that, you know, a lot of people, I hear this on social media, a lot of people ask me through my workshops, they ask me all these questions, and their whole question is that, how do we get our children to read? And you know, when I think back to my childhood, you know, my parents loved to read. Okay, and we always had books around us. So a message that I'd actually like to give parents is, surround yourself with books. Even if you are not a big reader, have the books around. You know, I today actually read not just books which are adult books for me, those I read of course, but I make sure that I read all the children's books that are coming out regularly, only so that I'm in touch. You know, so, and I have something to connect with my children and my grandchildren now. So I surround myself with books, you know, and so does my daughter. And when I look at my granddaughter, I think if I'm not mistaken, her first word was bookie book at 1 year old or something. And now she's actually, I mean, I make sure right now, of course, bookshops are closed, but otherwise an outing for her in Mumbai is taking her to a bookstore, allowing her to browse, and then letting her choose one or two books to buy. So that love for reading is not something that you put a gun to them and say, read. It's got to be something that they love doing. I know we did this with our son when, you know, because he was obsessed with dogs when he was really little, and I found that he wasn't reading. We found that, you know, he was more interested in sport and doing other things, which was great, but we wanted him also to read. So we bought him books on dogs. So it was through the subject that he got into the book. And then of course he got into reading. So I think that it's very important for parents to also keep books around everywhere. And for kids, I would say just read. It doesn't matter what you read. It's always going to be good for you. So what books should children read today? Just about any book that interests them. And like I just said, surrounding your book, your home with books is an excellent idea. But if you have a library to go to, that's even better, because then they can take and give back. And all the books that I told you about earlier, all of my books which I've done, many of them, as I said, are for Puffin, Penguin. They're all available at the House of Books and Tales, which is a library as well as somewhere where you can procure books as well. So I do hope all you children and parents enjoy the journey that books bring you. You know, just imagine, books are something in which I feel you can travel the world while staying in the same place. So keep reading. Bye.